happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus wore.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us today. We're going to talk about a Carnegie Mellon University and UCLA study about, is a meditation habit the secret to bulletproofing your immune system? This is interesting, and it gives us a lot of hope that we can overcome or prevent many stress-related conditions. Those would include heart disease. Also from the Max Planck Institute for Human Development comes a study that shows that living near a forest keeps your brain's amygdala healthier. That's good. And additionally, blueberries may improve attention in children following double-blind trials, University of Reading in the United Kingdom. And also, we'll look at how learning and staying in shape is a key to a longer lifespan, University of Edinburgh, and a whole lot more on this topic. I have a guest in the second part of our program, and that guest is Daniel Golden from Boston. And Daniel is a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative journalist. He is the current senior editor at ProPublica, which is a Boston-based nonprofit newsroom covering topics in public interest. And he also was the former managing editor for education at Bloomberg News. And we're going to talk about the exploitation of American universities and academia by the CIA and the FBI and foreign intelligence agencies. Meaning, how do we know that something covering a university on these issues that we talk about are not plants, are not misinformation campaigns? We don't, and we should be very concerned based upon what he has uncovered. In light of that today, I'll be playing a rare, very old interview that a person I had a great deal of respect for, Gil Noble. I believe, I'm not sure, I wasn't in town, but I heard he passed in the last year. But I was on Gil's show several times. I shared a lot of information with him over the years. And Gil did an investigation where he found a person who was willing to show how deep the deep state, including the FBI, was willing to infiltrate every peaceful black organization in the United States and then commit crimes. And you'll be hearing from the church committee. You'll hear new information that you did not know about Malcolm X's death. The charge against Malcolm X is, quite frankly, it's none of my business, or what he is alleged to have been killed for. True or not true is not up to me to debate. What is important is what is said at the end about who was in that audience that no one knew. No one I was talking to knew. Brand new information there, and shows that if they were infiltrating every single peaceful, nonviolent organization, then, and they had over 1,000 black individuals, infiltrators they were using, how many people are they using today, even in the most innocuous of institutions like, you know, a vegan movement? It seems though any corporation that feels threatened by any social movement, they can count upon these people to go out there and do their work for them, meaning infiltrate, cause disruptions, act as agent provocateurs, and cause harm to be coming to the person, their reputation, or the destruction of the institution. So we'll hear from that. So that's our show today. We have a lot to share. I believe that meditation is a very powerful and useful tool. Now, there are different types of meditation, and it's possible that they all work. I believe in what is called mindful meditation, of the ones that I have studied, and I know that when I'm out doing a long workout, I'm meditating. I'm conscious. I'm aware of my environment. I'm aware of the smells and the sights and the sounds, especially of nature. That's one of the reasons I used to like to go into Central Park early in the morning, because there were very few people out there. There were very few before it was sunlight, very, very few. But you could really appreciate the park, this wonderful oasis in the middle of a great city. Now, when you're in the country, it's even better, because then you can sustain that almost all day. But we don't do enough getting close to nature, and we certainly don't do a lot of meditation. But according to the Carnegie Mellon University in UCLA, usually we don't think of our immune system as highly intelligent and flexible. Rather mechanical. It's a process that we hope will take care of business in the background with minimal issues. In the world of science, however, this orientation radically changed in the 1980s when it was discovered that the immune system is actually a floating brain. What do I mean? That means that our immune cells throughout the body respond to chemical messages. Incredibly, researchers found that every thought, every mood, every sensation, every expectation we have is relayed to our immune system through these messengers, and thereby wielding incredible power over how efficient or not our body is able to fight disease. And taking it a step further, scientists began to explore how this process is influenced by meditation. What they found is inspiring. It's about the powerful connection between meditation and health. Remarkably sensitive to both negative and positive thoughts, the immune system reflects where we are at any given time, emotionally, physically, and mentally. And with this in mind, researchers examine how meditation can create a positive mental state, which in turn helps boost immunity. They published the results in the journal Brain Behavior and Immunity, and they discovered that when older adults, over 50, participated in an 8-week mindfulness-based stress reduction program, there was a significant decrease in the expression of pro-inflammatory genes, which resulted in a lower risk of loneliness and subsequent healthy relationship to our day-to-day lives. And another study also demonstrated meditation had a favorable impact on immunity. When a group of biotech workers participated in weekly meditation classes, and they were people who were normal, they were not highly stressed, they found that they had notably higher levels of antibodies compared to the control group who didn't meditate. And that means that the body was creating antibodies to respond to any antigen. There's been more than 20 randomized controlled trials to establish the effect of mindfulness meditation on the immune system. So here's what we know today that the science has proven. Reduce markers of inflammation, meaning you'll have less arthritis, less inflammation in your brain, in your eyes, in your heart. Higher levels of which are often correlated with decreased immune function, and also increased number of CD4 cells, which are the immune system's helper cells that are involved in sending signals to other cells telling them to destroy infections. Increased telomerase activity, and telomerase help promote the stability of chromosomes and prevent their deterioration. And telomerase deterioration leads to cancer and premature aging. So all good, and this is just the beginning. So what we have to do is start to recognize that every thought we have will have a corresponding outcome. When you de-stress yourself, you automatically increase emotional regulation. That means that when we meditate, even for 20 minutes, we encourage health-giving chemical messages from the brain, which reduce the level of stress, a proven health killer, and decreases rumination and increases our ability to handle difficult emotions. And then we activate the second brain. Our second brain is in our gut. So mindfulness can stimulate immunity via the gut microbiota, of which the latter plays a major role in a healthy immune response. When I counsel people, one of the first things I do is I examine whether or not their lifestyle encourages a healthy gut or an unhealthy gut. And it's amazing how many people think because they may not have eaten meat or dairy that somehow they're healthy. They don't look at that sugar and what sugar does to your gut microbiota, or antibiotics can destroy. And the only bacteria that are not destroyed become resistant to antibiotics, so therefore when you need an antibiotic, when an antibiotic should save your life, it's not working on your behalf because you've taken it too often. So try to meditate in the morning. Try to meditate in the evening. We can't avoid stress in our lives. It's a normal part of living. But we can keep our immune system strong. And meditation keeps our immune system strong. The Max Planck Institute for Human Development in Germany did a study. They investigated the relationship between the availability of nature near city dwellers' homes and their brain health. And its findings are relevant for urban planners. Noise, pollution, and many people in a confined space, that's city life. And that can cause chronic stress. So city dwellers are at a higher risk of psychiatric illness, such as depression and anxiety disorders, than people living in the country. And comparisons show higher activity levels in city dwellers than in country dwellers' amygdala, a central nucleus in the brain that plays an important role in stress processing and reactions to danger, which factors can have a protective influence. And a research team led by a psychologist, Dr. Kahn, has examined which affects nature near people's homes, such as forest or green like lawns or wasteland. And these end up having less stress. So the more green, the more water, the more at peace we are in those environments. So get your green, and it's helping your brain, and it's helping your brain deal with stress, and it's impacting the amygdala, and you're going to reduce your brain aging. And talking about healthy, blueberries can improve attention in children. This was a double-blind trial done at the University of Reading in the United Kingdom. They took a group of primary school children, and they could show better attention by consuming flavonoid-rich blueberries. And it was published in Food and Function. They took 7 to 10-year-olds who consumed a drink containing wild blueberries, or they gave them a placebo. And they tested this on their speed and accuracy in completing an executive task function on a computer. It was a double-blind trial, and they found that when you had those flavonoid-rich blueberries, you were much quicker in your reaction time on a test without any sacrifice of accuracy. In particular, the effect was more noticeable as the test got harder. Quote from a professor, Claire Williams, neuroscience professor, "This is the first time that we have seen the positive impact of flavonoids on the executive function of children. We designed this double-blind trial especially to test how flavonoids would impact on attention in young people, as it's an area of cognitive performance that hasn't been measured before. We used wild blueberries, as they are rich in flavonoids, which are compounds found naturally in foods such as fruits and their juices." So they got positive outcome. Now why? Well, not all flavonoids are the same. For example, you have antho, A-N-T-H-O, cyanins, C-Y-A-N-I-N-S. They're found in berries, but blueberries, very high. Aronia berries, very, very high. high orac, high benefit to the body, but cherries too. Then you have flavanols, and they're found in onions and leeks and broccoli. And flavanones, they're found in parsley and celery. And isoflavones, they're found in soy and soy products. And then you have flavanones found in citrus, lemons, limes, grapefruit, oranges, and tomatoes. And then you have the flavanols found in green tea and red wine and chocolate. So just imagine having a diet that has a combination of these different elements and how much healthier you're going to be. So for all the parents out there or grandparents who have some positive influence upon their grandchildren, encourage them to have wild blueberries. You can get them frozen, organic wild blueberries. And just put a cup into a blender and blend it up into a smoothie. And you don't even have to add anything else. It by itself, maybe put a little apple juice in, and it would make a great drink for all young children. Maybe some of the school teachers, we have a lot of teachers listening to this program. You might encourage the parents to have flavanone positive, because let's just say that someone brought a meal and the meal had some tempeh. But you can tell them now, if you get onions, broccoli, parsley, celery, citrus, tomatoes, then you've got a really rich diet, rich in the nutrients of the anthocyanins that help the body. These are the flavonoids. And that's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null, back in a moment. Please stay with us.
Come out here on the floor. Let's rock some more. Come out of here on the floor. Honey, let's rock some more, yeah. Now when you get out here, don't you have no fear. Put your hands on your hip and let your backbone slip and work out.
Nice to have you with us, everyone. I'm Gary Null. If our engineers in New York have our segment ready, we go to the Noble clip where he is interviewing an infiltrator, an agent provocateur, a person who acknowledges that he committed arson and that he befriended people only to turn them over, that there were over 1,000 people like him all over the United States, that every group was infiltrated. Let's hear what Gil Noble has to say in this before we go to our guest, because it ties together.
It's loading.
And it's about 22 minutes, and when we're not going to go 22 minutes. We'll go half that amount. But I'll share enough of it. You'll have a chance to see how deep this infiltration went. And it was all illegal. And no one has been held accountable to this date. And it didn't stop back then. So if it's loaded, we'll play it.
I interviewed a man who worked as an informer for the FBI during the 1960s. His name is Dothard Perry, also known as Ed Riggs, also known as Bill Perry, also known as Othello.
How are you paid?
The pay was always in cash. Cash, and you would sign a card. It would go like this. A rendezvous or a drop-off point would be picked out either by yourself or the agent. You would meet the agent there. Usually it would be in a vehicle. You get in the vehicle, he would hand you the money. He would tell you first to count the money. He would tell you the amount while you counted it. If the amount was there, he would then bring out a card. On that card would be for the week of such and such, in other words, the week was dated, so-and-so has been paid the amount of. Then you would sign the card, and then the agent would sign the card. The reason for this is that if all of a sudden the IRS became very interested about where you were getting all this extra money from. You could always tell them to go back to the Bureau and the Bureau would have your cards on file.
I see. Were there such things as bonuses?
Oh, yes.
What were they paid for?
Bonuses were paid for, suppose while you were meeting with, or you were at a meeting with Bobby Seals, Chulai of the Red Army happened to come to the meeting too, which is something which would be a new development. That's bonus time.
In other words, a hot piece of information.
Hot piece, very hot piece.
Did you ever suffer pangs of conscience?
Quite a few times. Quite a few times. I still suffer pangs of conscience. I suffer from the fact that a lot of people trusted me, and I misused that trust. I suffer from the fact that a lot of information that I gave out was the undoing of certain groups or certain people. I suffer from the fact that I'm on the run constantly. I have no real life to speak of.
You have no family life, really? You have a wife?
No, I don't have a wife. I do have a child. I can't see her that often. I have to stay away from them because once I come around, the Bureau shows up and harassment starts. I have very few close personal friends, no one to really confide in. It's like being on the outside of a glass jar and everything is happening inside the jar, but you're on the outside. You can see it happening, but you can't participate.
Why have you decided to talk to me?
For the simple reason, I think this information should be put out to the public. I think not only black people, but everyone should become aware of what your so-called law enforcement agencies do to so-called enforce the law. Because between you, myself, and the audience, I've seen more felons in law enforcement than I have in prison.
Many would say, well, look, you yourself just got through saying that the DLA was involved in criminal activity. What's wrong with wanting to put them in prison? How would you answer them?
I would answer them this way. First off, we have to understand why they did what they did. But I'm not even going to go off into that psychological hoo-ha. What I'm going to say is when you become just as bad as the people that you go after, then there's nothing gained and a whole lot lost.
All right, let's stop it right there. I just wanted to do the introduction. Now the engineer is going to skip through to almost 57 minutes into this interview because this is where he's already in the interim. He has discussed how he joined a theater group and got into their theater and helped build their theater. Later came back and torched it, arsoned it, burned it to the ground. All this at the behest of the FBI. How there was a guy in a car, there were three of them in a car, and one of the guys in the car was aware that there had been an informer. So he got shot. And this guy right now was in the car when this other guy got shot, and they had to put gasoline on his body and set him on fire. Only then did he find out that the other guy indeed was an informer. So the three guys who were in the car, two were FBI informers. The FBI was fully aware of this. Nothing ever happened. And that there were over 1,000 individuals doing what he was doing. If you were any black person, if you had any black group in America, you were our target. Now we're going to go to that section that also, for the first time, I didn't know this existed. But under a congressional hearing, two FBI agents come forward and they're grilled about their investigating Martin Luther King. This is particularly interesting if this is in the segment that we're going to play for you now.
I'm trying to find out what it was that impelled some part of the FBI to pursue Martin Luther King with such an obsession. And what I understood that answer to be is, first of all, it was not any suspicions of the commission of a federal crime. None of the literature showed up a single suggestion that Martin Luther King had committed or was about to commit a crime. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yes, Senator, but at this point, much of what was being done did involve challenges to local laws. And there is a very strong suggestion that King was seen as rallying the lawbreakers and would-be lawbreakers, albeit for a cause that sounded pure. I'm looking now in terms of, if we look at what might have gotten the Bureau started, and if we remember at the same time, he is extremely critical of the Bureau's own law enforcement efforts. We see throughout these documents and the New Left documents that it is taboo to criticize the Bureau, right, and particularly the director.
Well, was he ever charged with fomenting violence? Did he ever participate in violence? Was it ever alleged that he was about to be violent?
That was the very opposite of his philosophy, Senator.
So that it was neither the fear of commission of a crime or the commission of violence. Was there any serious charge that he himself was a communist?
No such charge ever was made.
So that what was left then was a decision on the part of some persons or person within the FBI that he should nevertheless be pursued.
And replaced.
And the basis for that apparently was political. The decision that he was dangerous or potentially dangerous to someone's notion of what this country should be doing, and a further theory that the FBI possessed the ability to enter into this field and to investigate and to intimidate and seek to neutralize and indeed replace a civil rights leader that they thought to be politically unacceptable. Is that correct?
Yes.
Correct. All right. And the tactics they used apparently had no end. Microphonic surveillance of hotel rooms. They included informants. They included sponsoring of letters signed by phony names to relatives and friends and organizers. They involved even plans to replace him with someone else the FBI was to select as a national civil rights leader. Is that correct?
Yes, that plan didn't get very far.
But it was seriously considered, and Mr. Hoover penned a note to that suggestion commending its authors, did they not?
Yes.
Right. It also included an indirect attempt to persuade the Pope not to see him.
And many other people.
A direct attempt to persuade one of our major universities not to grant him a doctorate degree.
That's correct. After the March on Washington, there was an acceleration. He was defined because of his speech in that demonstration in Washington as the most dangerous and effective leader in the country, and there was a paper battle within the Bureau as to how best to attack him, and he was attacked. After Time magazine named him as Man of the Year, again, the Bureau finds that reprehensible, believes it must attack and destroy. When he was given the Nobel Prize, again, they seek to discredit Dr. King with the persons who welcomed him back from that award. When he began to speak out against the Vietnam War, there's a new crescendo of efforts by the Bureau to discredit and destroy Dr. King.
It is my feeling that the assassination of Dr. King was a part of a conspiracy in the country, and I do believe that some individuals in very high places of our government were involved in this conspiracy. And it is the same conspiracy that eliminated and destroyed President Kennedy, Senator Kennedy, Malcolm X, Medgar Evers, and so many other freedom and human rights individuals.
I'm convinced that the government was involved at some level. I will never separate the conduct, the attitude of Hoover and the FBI from Dr. King's assassination. I never will do that.
I think one of the most important things that come out in that investigation was that Martin Luther King in Memphis was in a white hotel, and the FBI admitted that they leaked to the press that Dr. King was staying in a white hotel instead of a black hotel, and it was that embarrassment that forced Dr. King to move into the Lorraine Hotel where he was killed.
There are more questions regarding the FBI's role in the assassination of Dr. King. For example, why was Dr. King stripped of his protection just before he was killed in Memphis? Reporter Les Payne and myself interviewed police officer Ed Reddit of the Memphis Police Department, who told how he was mysteriously removed from his security post near Dr. King. However, later, his superior, Chief Holloman, denied doing so.
Why do you feel you were pulled away from your assignment of surveillance that day? Why do you think they pulled you away?
I think because whoever pulled the trigger, I could identify.
When there were complaints from somebody, did we reduce manpower at the Lorraine? Did we reduce manpower in
no.
the area?
No.
The attorneys general in 1965 had for 25 years authorized wiretaps in a fairly widespread fashion. This was just one. At the very most, the only thing I can think of that I would have done, but I didn't even do that, was go talk to Bob Kennedy and ask him about it. But Mr. Katzenbach, in whom I also had great confidence, without giving me the details, said that it was all right, that he had, that there were no, it was not being done anymore, it would not be done anymore, and that there was just nothing to worry about.
I think the issue is the neo-fascist police state mentality that pervaded the intelligence community, that is a danger to America to this day.
Malcolm X was kept under heavy FBI surveillance since he got out of prison back in 1953.
That just gives you a little insight into a longer interview, which we have posted. I'll just explain what was extremely important for me in hearing all of it. You heard almost all the major respected civil rights leaders at the time giving certain points. Also, the CIA director was under oath and admitted at that time that not only was it routine to bring members of the media, including the major networks, into the CIA's, let's say, realm of influence, but to plant stories. And they could bring a story to a particular perspective based upon that they wanted, based upon the relationship they had. And there were a lot of people who pride themselves in being super patriots and anti-communists, that if you were anything representing liberal or progressive, then you could fare very poorly as far as what would be written about you or broadcast about you. And one of the people who was being interviewed, who was the news director of CBS, said that they met regularly, and they were proud of that association. And there were over 1,400 that were at that time. How many today? We do not know. But it didn't stop. The wiretapping didn't stop. And what he was about to say, and it's a long piece where he goes on to Malcolm X, is that the day that Malcolm X was shot, inside that church, there were multiple FBI, armed FBI individuals. He was being monitored everywhere he went. So why is it the FBI who were there, why did they not make the arrest? Why did not intervene? Why did not try to save Malcolm X? Why were they never brought to the public's attention? But that's unfortunately how that deep state frequently works. and I think that that should be pursued to this day. We're going over now to my guest who is standing by. I mentioned his background a little earlier in the program. He's in Boston, Daniel Golden. And Daniel is a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative journalist, current as senior editor at ProPublica, which is up in Boston, and it's a nonprofit newsroom covering topics in the public interest, and he is also the former managing editor for education at Bloomberg News. And Dan received his first Pulitzer Award for his Wall Street Journal series on admission of inequality at the elite universities, and later a Pulitzer for his Bloomberg series on how U.S. corporations dodge taxes by moving their bases overseas. Another nomination was for university exploitation of veterans and poor students and the homeless. He also received three Polk Awards, and his most recent book is Spy Schools, How the CIA, FBI, and Foreign Intelligence Secretly Exploit America's Universities, which documents the infiltration of academia by domestic and foreign intelligence services with some, I think, shocking stories. Nice to have you stayed, Daniel.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, Gary.
Daniel, we know that nations' foreign intelligence agency have been playing the spy game upon each other for decades, and in fact for centuries. But we normally do not consider university campuses as the playground for espionage, both domestic and international. It is our myth that the citadels of higher education are free of commercial and government exploitation. And it's assumed that students are free from private and government influences, and university administrations pursue education for its own sake. And during the Vietnam War, most college campuses were incubators for free speech, and administrations more or less supported student activism. And research was usually independent and solely in order to pursue greater understanding in various scientific and humanity disciplines. But this has changed dramatically. Universities today are deeply interconnected with private corporate interests, which frequently fund them and sometimes fund them generously. I think of the student strikes at Harvard Medical School several years back because of the enormous influence the pharmaceutical companies had on medical education there, or the fact that agriculture departments at University of California, Davis, and Cornell University have become, at times, mouthpieces for Monsanto and DuPont and industrial food companies, and even fund separate media departments at both of these schools to promote genetically modified organisms. And now, as you have wonderfully documented, campuses are also increasingly becoming the victims of intelligence agencies, not only the CIA and the FBI, but also some foreign countries. You contribute the rise in spying on college campuses with the increased globalization. Could you then share with us some of the more interesting aspects of this phenomena to show us that now we have to be very conscious of what we're learning or being influenced by on college campuses that is not in our best interest? The forum is yours.
Thank you. I appreciate it. You make a number of good points. What I basically found was that, as you said, globalization has led to universities sort of becoming a front line for espionage, as there's more and more foreign students and researchers. Some of them are helping their countries steal, our scientific secrets from government-funded research on campus, or to cultivate informants who can give them insights into foreign policy. And at the same time, the FBI and CIA are very active recruiting some of the foreign students and researchers in the hope that they can send them home as our agents. So there's this kind of covert espionage going on from both sides. Another cause is, as you mentioned, in the old days, there was a lot of sort of protest and resistance of kind of CIA and FBI incursions on campus, but that's faded partly because sort of the national mood has changed, partly because universities are quite dependent on funding from the military and the intelligence community for research projects, and so on. And some of the things I found, for example, on the foreign espionage side, I tell the story of a Chinese graduate student at Duke who was working on Pentagon-funded invisibility research, the idea being to make, our fighter planes or our tanks invisible, and they're making progress on that. But essentially, he kind of poached that research, brought it back to China, started a competing institute, got a lot of patents, and became a billionaire with the Chinese government's help. And there were an awful lot of things he did in retrospect that sort of took advantage of the kind of naivete of the American universities, the sort of lack of intellectual property controls, lack of collaboration agreements, so that he exploited all that to get this research back to China. And on the domestic side, I document that for years in the at the Kennedy School, Harvard's Kennedy School, which is the premier sort of training program for public policy, there's been a long line of CIA officers enrolled undercover in the mid-career program, which is a program predominantly composed of foreigners, foreign business people, government officials, and the like. And the CIA officers enroll undercover using their foreign covers, you know, State Department diplomats, embassy political officers, and the like. And this enables them to, you know, be sitting side to side with foreigners who would make, you know, very good informants and sources. And they're not supposed to officially recruit them during that year, but, of course, they get to be friendly. The foreigner doesn't realize they're talking to a CIA agent, and it leads to kind of possibly co-opting them as sources in future. So those are, you know, a couple of the examples. Another is there's a Chinese university that to all intents and purposes appears to the outside like a normal university, but it's called the University of International Relations. But actually, it's run by, it's partly funded and overseen by China's intelligence ministry. And it has been developing relationships with universities in the West, including in the U.S., in order to have a place where its students, some of them future Chinese spies, get to know American culture. And I described this in one chapter, its partnership with Marietta College, which is a small liberal arts college in Ohio. And essentially, the university in China helps Marietta get full tuition-paying foreign students, Chinese students, and Marietta is struggling financially, so it kind of turns a blind eye to the fact that it has a partnership with China's spy university, and it sends faculty over there to teach classes at the Chinese university, and it accepts transfers from student transfers and from there, and they have quite a close relationship, and but it's a little worrisome. So these are some of the aspects that I go into.
By the way, it's just not, as you mentioned, Harvard University's JFK Center of School of Government, but also the Rand Institute at Stanford University would be another example. Is there a particular case story you investigated of either domestic or foreign spying on campuses that best exemplifies the extent of the problem today?
Well, I think, you know, taken in combination, they all do. And I also have some statistics that are pretty alarming. It's hard for me to roll them off the cuff, but I remember that one statistic, for example, is there was a poll taken of people who worked in kind of the foreign students office at American universities, and they said that something like 30% of them had visits from the FBI in regard to a student in the past year. 30% of students had been visited, which gives you a sense of, you know, how interested U.S. intelligence is in these foreign students. There's been, you know, from abroad, there's been a big increase in what they call academic solicitations. The Defense Department tracks that, efforts to kind of entrap American academics. So, you know, so the statistics kind of back up the anecdotes. And I'd say that the one at Duke that I mentioned of the invisibility researcher is quite symptomatic because, you know, studies show the broader problem, which is that universities rarely teach kind of intellectual property courses outside of law school. So people in the sciences who develop the kind of intellectual property that other countries are interested in don't know much about the laws. Most universities don't have collaboration agreements. So in that case, what the researcher did was he brought in some Chinese collaborators. There was no real discussion of what research should be shared and what shouldn't, so they were able to basically access all the research. They sent people over who took photos of the lab equipment that Duke had built. China has a program, various programs called the 100 Talents and 1,000 Talents programs and other programs which are designed to offer wonderful lab facilities and salaries and others to academics in other countries who will go back to China and, who will go to China and take a job there. And, kind of the message there is don't come home empty-handed. So sort of researchers in the U.S. of Chinese descent have kind of an incentive to poach American research and bring it back to China. And in this case, those under the name of those programs, the researcher at Duke kind of signed up his professor to go to China and talk about his research, and the professor wasn't really cognizant of what he was signing. So there's just a whole lot of that case is kind of a window on a whole lot of ways that the kind of open, global, trusting nature of academia can be manipulated. And as I say, by either side.
I'm also deeply concerned about the pressure that our intelligence agencies place on university freedoms to host different people. For example, Chris Hedges, who I know, and I consider him a deeply noble person of great integrity, was scheduled to give a commencement speech at a college, and pressure on the administration forced the school to renege on the invitation. Harvard did something similar recently with Chelsea Manning, who was scheduled to talk. In other words, in the name of a faux national security, government and U.S. intelligence is trying to dictate what college students can or not hear. If they don't feel that someone has anything to say that would be offensive, fine, then they don't interfere. But you get someone like Chris Hedges or Chelsea Manning, when they talk, they generally are going to dig a little deeper into something of substance and could influence the way people think. So shouldn't this disturb more Americans? And can you share a little bit about the financial incentive colleges receive from government? You mentioned it earlier, but to what extent? And to allow intelligence operatives and programs to be invited on campuses?
Well, you make a very good point. And to take up the Chelsea Manning example that you mentioned, here's a case where Harvard invited her to be a visiting fellow and then rescinded the invitation when the CIA, both sort of its former top people and its current top brass, protested. And, I think that should be seen in the light of the, many ties between Harvard's Kennedy School and the CIA. I mean, as I mentioned, my book focuses on one that's never been reported about the undercover enrollment of the CIA officers in the mid-career program. But there's many other ties. Graduates of the Kennedy School may well go to work for the CIA. The CIA provides, speakers. They fund other programs at the Kennedy School. There's one called the Recanati Kaplan Fellowships, which is for intelligence analysts. The more ties there are between academia and government, the harder it is for academia to resist when the government says, this person shouldn't speak. And it is a concern, and there's a lot of programs that have cropped up in the last 10 to 15 years since 9/11 that involve, military or intelligence funding for academic research. There's centers of excellence for intelligence research type programs. And universities bid for these and then they get awarded the contracts, and there may not be an explicit, quid pro quo or strings attached, but in the long run, naturally they want to please their funders. And so it shapes what happens. And, the same thing is true to some extent on the foreign side. I mean, there's hundreds of what they call Confucius Institutes around the world, including, 100 at least in the U.S. on different college campuses, which are funded and staffed to a large degree by China. And so if you have the Confucius Institute on campus, you may be more reluctant to, say, invite the Dalai Lama to speak or somebody like that, somebody who is out of favor with the Chinese regime. And so, inevitably, money talks, and universities are beholden to their funders from whatever direction they come. The other case I go into in this context in my book is of a Chinese-born professor at the University of South Florida, now an American citizen, but he grew up there. And he was the director of one of these Confucius Institutes at the University of South Florida. And the FBI regards these institutes as potential havens for Chinese spies, and this particular professor got in trouble for some financial wrongdoing, expense account finagling, that kind of thing. And the FBI basically went to him and said, look, you've got two options. You know, you can lose your professorship and maybe go to prison for your financial wrongdoing, or you can, you know, keep your tenured professorship and spy on the Confucius Institutes in China for us. And it's actually an interesting story because the professor played them quite well. He sort of agreed to spy for the FBI without really meaning it, and he did relatively little. Meanwhile, the university was considering firing the professor for those financial activities, and the FBI prevailed on the university not to fire him. So they kind of intervened in the academic independence of the university, and there's a whole chain of emails that I got that show them pressuring the university to go easy on the professor. And then in the end, like I said, they didn't get much for their intervention on his behalf. One of the most shocking things I found was that along the way, at one point they asked the university to open a branch in China that the professor could use as a base for spying. And that went too far for the university at that point. South Florida balked, and they didn't do that for the FBI. But as they bent for a long time before their backbone finally stiffened.
I appreciate the scholarship that it took, the time and patience to write Spy Schools: How the CIA, FBI, and Foreign Intelligence Secretly Exploit American Universities. The website is ProPublica.org. My guest, Daniel Golden, G-O-L-D-E-N. I know that you're concerned that a lot of students are going there with some idealistic views, and we individually and collectively have not been informed how pervasive the propagandizing is and what is at stake. And my hope is that this becomes a topic of wider discussion and gets into the mainstream consciousness. And so you can have some legitimate debates. I'd like to see some of these debates so a larger audience hears about you. Thank you very much, Daniel, for coming on.
Thank you. It was my pleasure. Great questions. Thanks. Bye.
Daniel Golden. I'm Gary Null. I want to end our program today by taking on a few issues. I can't get through all of it, but it's posted. It's from The Hill, a person you've heard on this program, Garth Porter. Also, you've heard Lawrence Wilkerson. He used to be the Chief of Staff for Colin Powell. And here's what they say about Congress and America's role in Saudi Arabia's war in Yemen. The Saudi Arabian-led war in Yemen is a tragedy of epic proportions in which the United States is deeply and directly involved. The war has caused mass starvation and a cholera epidemic that is worse than any the world has witnessed in the past 50 years, with the latest estimates of Yemen victims at well over 500,000 dead. This horrific situation is the result of Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, bombing of roads, hospitals, bridges, water and sewage facilities, and the main port, combined with Saudi United Arab Emirates' naval and air blockade that prevents large-scale humanitarian assistance from reaching the Yemen war victims. Even apart from the need to halt this growing humanitarian disaster, Congress has a constitutional obligation to deal with United States participation in this war. Flatly stated, the United States participation is illegal. When President Barack Obama ordered U.S. involvement, the Saudi-led war was not covered by the authorization for use of military force issued by Congress in the wake of 9/11. The Houthis and the forces of former Yemeni President Saleh, against whom the Saudi coalition is engaged, are not affiliated with al-Qaeda or any other entity associated with the 9/11 terror attacks. That is why a bipartisan group of House members should be introducing Congressional Resolution 81, giving Congress an opportunity to end U.S. support. The resolution instructs the president to withdraw U.S. military personnel from the war, except the U.S. military elements that are strictly aimed at al-Qaeda elements in Yemen. Even if House members are indifferent to the fact that Congress did not authorize U.S. support for the war, they should take account of the fact that such support has increased the security threat to all Americans. the Saudi-led war in Yemen, enabled by United States support, has strengthened America's most dangerous enemies in the Middle East, Al-Qaeda and the Arabian Peninsula. U.S. intelligence and counterterrorism officials have regarded that organization as even more of a foreign terrorist threat to the United States than ISIS. It mounted efforts to bring down U.S. airlines three times between 2009 and 2012 and nearly succeeded twice. But the Saudi-United Arab Emirates war in Yemen has made them the most powerful indigenous group in southern Yemen, with more money, more arms, more territorial control than ever before. The Saudi-led coalition and the forces of the Saudi-backed former regime have allied openly with ISIS, or with Al-Qaeda, and even fought alongside them. As a result of the war, Al-Qaeda is now poised for the first time to compete for national power in Yemen. The war is also increasing anti-American sentiment in Yemen. So members of Congress refuse to support congressional some members of Congress refuse to support it because they accept the official rationale for U.S. involvement in the war created by the Obama administration. They argue that the United States has no choice but to support the Saudi-led war because it's necessary to oppose an expansionist Iran. But it is widely recognized that the Houthis are not Iranian proxies. They pursue their own interests and strategy. So I thank Lawrence Wilkerson, retired U.S. Army colonel and former chief of staff to Secretary of State Colin Powell, and Garth Porter, an investigative journalist, historian, and author on U.S. wars and national security policy. So remember, our taxpayers' dollars are going to support a war against people who have no means of fighting back and who are dying and sickened, starving in massive numbers. And we should hold some moral high ground and get out of this mess. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. I look forward to sharing more on our next program. Have a nice day, everyone.